Please rise for a pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First of all, I'm Lisa Mays from the UPC, and I just want to thank you for inviting the village clergy to be part of this. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord God, we do invite you. We do invite you to be present in this meeting. We ask that you would give us wisdom and guidance and direction. And most of all, Lord, I pray that there would be a sense of togetherness, a sense of unity focused on our town. Lord, help these leaders to make wise decisions and to work together for the betterment of our town. And we do ask, Lord God, as we ask for your blessing on this evening, that you would bless our town with health and security and safety and good old-fashioned, wholesome living. We pray these things in your name, O Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Okay, I think you've all had a chance to review the minutes. Are there any corrections or changes?
I'll make a motion we approve them as submitted.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Passed. At this time, we'll have our floor time. Folks, this is a chance for you to speak. Share with us your thoughts. We just ask that you stand and state your name and address.
Sorry. Hi, I'm Dan Broughton. I live on Loomisbrook, town of Walton. Last month, my husband Greg was here over the concern of all the abandoned cars on our road. And we were wondering whether or not any decision has been made or if anybody's gone to check on them.
I went up.
I did too.
So did I.
But all of us going up doesn't make as much of a difference as you're going up, and I know you did.
I went up. I made a short list, I think, of four or five properties. I don't remember off the top of my head now. Those individuals received, not all of them did, because one of them got sent back to me, but I sent letters indicating there appeared to be an issue there, and to please rectify the issue within 30 days. Or otherwise contact me to, you know, if there actually wasn't an issue, just to clarify what was going on. So, and we're still in our 30-day period for that.
And since then, we've had two more properties, and each with one more abandoned car. It's like your dump
derby season.
Could you pass those to Steve, the addresses?
Those other two, yes.
Yeah. You could just give us a call.
There are single cars on each of these properties, and I know you can have one.
Yeah, you can have one.
Yeah, you can have one, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam.
I'm Rob Cocklin from Palmer Hill, and there's several of us here from New York City's acquisition of a hunk of land up there, and we're trying to get it so it's not open up to rifle hunting. We don't mind bow hunting or small game, but rifle hunting is just too many houses in the neighborhood hidden in the woods that somebody's gonna get hit. So I see you got it on the agenda for farther down. But
yes, we do. Well, thank you. And you all provided us with a petition with several names on it as well, of the neighbors. So, good. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Okay.
You're here from Palmer Hill too, I'm assuming?
Yeah. Hi, I'm Dave Richards, Bob's neighbor, and Linda Rice, and got Mike Babcock here. And, you know, we just feel that the way the property lies, it's just the houses, you know, it's a 46 acre property, and you got like seven houses at border, if one is in the middle of it. You know, 46 acres, like 30 of it is hay meadows. It's like really not, you know, a safe situation for rifle hunting.
Which are okay with small game hunting,
small game hunting, anything else, muzzle loader even, you know, but general rifle season tends to be a little hairy, and, you know, which is concerned, you know, a lot of the houses are right in the line of sight, and Bob's got grandchildren living there. We're just really concerned about it.
Great.
That's it.
Thank you. If nobody else has anything they'd like to bring up, we'll go to the highway.
I only have a couple things. Kevin and I did meet a couple days ago anyway. We had talked, I had called last month when we were discussing, I think it was last month, maybe it was in the highway committee. We're unsure when that Dodge truck that we had ordered would be delivered. I had emailed Robert Green, and they thought within 30 days that they would be delivered to Monticello. Now, that didn't say that it would be ready to be picked up, but I'm thinking probably sometime the end of April, middle of May, we should probably take possession of that. With that, hopefully winter's over. We talked about sometime in between that surplusing the 2012 Dodge and doing that. I don't know what your thoughts are on that. Wanted to do that now, and if the weather forecast sounds like we're not going to have snow, which I have no idea whether to believe them or not, could get that on the auction site and see what you could go. The only other thing is I did look around, and we have a ditching bucket that we bought back when we bought the backhoe back in 2002, and we've never used it. Can either take up space there, or we could. What your thoughts are on surplusing that also and trying to get a few dollars for it. We haven't used it. Those are the two items that...
That was it? That's all we had?
That's all I really... I mean, we could... Probably what we ought to do, it's lighter now. We can take a wander around. I've walked around a little bit, taking a look, and...
Well, I'll make a motion. We declare those two items surplus and put them on the auction site.
I have a motion to have a second.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed.
With that, talking about the end of snow, hopefully summer's going to be here and mowing roadsides and all that other. You know, in the past couple of years, we've always had a couple of college students and also some older ones riding the tractor. I'm sure we're still on for that. I speculate the money was in the... I had asked for that money in the budget. And the other question I would have is for the roadside mowers, we've had them for 3 8-hour days like that, with the thought of, I'm not sure whether the crew wants to go to the 10 hours. I know, and if the contract hopefully be approved, and I'm not sure where that's at, but in one of these days, hopefully will be the, if we were to go to 10 hour days, would you still want to keep them at 8 hours or 10 hours?
Well, we don't want to, I mean, we budgeted so much money, so we got whatever way we can.
I budgeted it at 8 hours, and I'm speculating that would be there, but I thought I would pose that question.
I think we'll probably keep it at 8.
That's fine.
I would think for that.
Because what it was, with the 3 months they had, not all they can do to get everything mowed in a couple of spots, we go back a second time. By no means we had enough time to get around to everything the second time. Good. With the passage of the state budget, there was some increase in the CHIPS money for that. I believe we've gotten an increase of $51,914.71. That's about 25% increase. We had $227,000, so in adding $51,000 to that, $279,000. So that's kind of a nice little plus in there. This year will be the sixth year that we've had the hydro seeder. The grant that was written for the hydro seeder for the city to pay for it, we needed to maintain the deliverables for 5 years, and then we would have complete ownership of that. Although I think I'd like to keep it the way it is, because we're in need of seed and mulch again, and keeping the program that's worked that way. If we got out of it, they probably wouldn't want to buy the seed and the mulch anymore. I did talk with Graydon, and they're trying to work that into just an automatic thing, but told him I wanted to go out to bid for those items, and he told me to go. So in that process here, we've got enough to keep us going, but for what we had last year, we used probably between 60 and 70% of it. So I'm thinking every year it's grown with municipalities throughout the county, so I'm thinking that it's going to grow even more. So I do have the bid. I'll get it with Rhonda and get it in the paper and have bid openings for that for next month. That's all I have that I can think of.
Okay. Town clerk?
All right. Everyone should have my financial reports.
I am now on $3,958,686 collected, which puts me at 84% collected of my warrant. As of January 1st, 2016, we have collected $140 in late dog license renewal fees. We are still currently 66 dogs licensed past due, but the renewal fees, the law is working and they are paying it. One of them came in and was due for November. So we finally got him to come in. Report that over the past few years, I've just had people come in and ask about the procedure to rent Moore Park picnic area. And I just had a gentleman come in today as well and ask if he could be put on the calendar. We've never had such a thing where we've kept track of it. And I know Charlie and I reviewed the deeds and it looks like it was supposed to be a free service for people to go and picnic in that area. But like this gentleman was questioning whether he could rely on nobody else being there, you know, for a family gathering. So I don't know if that's something that we can look into or if it's something you want to look into to see about, at the very least, trying to establish a calendar for it. No.
I think it'd be a good idea to have a calendar. That way, if the folks are planning on something, they can look and say, okay, there's going to be a family reunion coming up there. I don't want to... I'll go someplace else, or.
But I don't really think we need to charge for it.
No, I don't think so either. But I think we need to. We'd have to advertise somehow that.
No, you can reserve the space.
That you can reserve it, yeah.
Okay. You can, but you don't need to. But it's then it's if it's reserved, then obviously you're at the one out of luck kind of mammy, because you don't really need to know that somebody's going to go up on a spur of a moment decide to go picnic that day.
Right.
They don't need to tell us, but if you want to be sure that it's your spot for the day, then you're the first dibs kind of thing, you'd have to put it on the calendar.
Correct.
It's going to be worded that
and
way.
I could post that on the website as well.
Do we need to address what privileges go with that? I mean, you're reserved it. It's info only, but are we going to preclude somebody that wants to take the family up and use the picnic area?
There are no picnic tables.
The tables are all gone now?
Well, the last time you were up there years ago, I remember going up to the fire department. It was burning, and I don't think anything's been been put back since then. And one other thing I would do is about the garbage, too. I mean, I do go up and keep track of garbage, and then all down the shop and whatever. There's not an awful lot on that, but there's really not.
So in other words, if somebody reserved it, they'd have to know that they moved the garbage.
Well,
you would know that they had been reserved, and then you could check on it, basically,
yeah,
too.
Do that. But people do go up for coffee in the morning occasionally, and I do see sometimes people go up there for lunch, sit in their car, and sometimes, rarely, I'm not up there all the time, but I do check it.
Sure, now we know where the wall is.
No, you can probably find me home. It's more comfortable in my recliner. The internet works better, but so sometimes they'll have a blanket out or sitting on the back pickup having lunch up there on the nicer days in the spring. As summer goes on, not so much, but in the springtime, if it's been cold and nasty, it seems like I see a few vehicles up there. I mean, it's not used a lot, but
it might be nice to put up there.
The only problem I can see with somebody reserving it, you know, if I'm somebody else that goes up there, I don't know where it's reserved or not.
Yeah.
You know, who's going to keep track of that?
Well, yeah, I think the thing is it's probably not going to overlap, but then they had a thing saying, look, we reserved it, then the other people
which
would
have
to
know. Which they could fill out a use of facility.
Yeah.
No, but what I'm saying is, if I'm just used to going up there, and I don't call here to see if any, you know, why would I call here to think that it might be reserved if for years I've been going up there whenever I felt like it, and I go up there, and I'm having a picnic with my family, somebody comes along and says, well, I reserved this, you know?
I mean, I don't think I've ever really seen more than one or two vehicles.
I would recommend a sign.
Yeah.
Placing a sign up there stating that this can be reserved by contacting,
I kind of think we're getting into something that's going to end up being a lot of work, a lot of aggravation for not much result.
What they call
I would put a sign up there, though, that says that if you bring in anything, carry out.
I think it's just kind of whoever's there is first come, first serves.
I don't mind it, but here it was, a month ago? Somebody left a pickup truck load of there was some carpeting, some chairs, and that doesn't happen.
Up there?
Yeah, instead of taking the landfill, they left it up there. Filled a pickup truck and then some. And that's not the first time either. A couple times a year, I found a tailgate up there off a pickup that's there, tires thrown in there, or they... Don Howe used to call all the time. He kept pretty good track of that up there, and he's since passed away. I kind of missed that.
Seems like it'd be easier to drive to the landfill.
I would think so, yeah. But no, seriously,
so just keep it as
a couple times a year, there's...
That's what I would do. I would think you're asking for more problems than it's worth if you start trying to reserve it and stuff and let people use it as a first-come, first-serve.
Yep.
If you want it on a Saturday morning or whatever, at noontime, but you get up there.
There's any spot to the
right. Okay, and then the only other thing I had is, as you can see, we are now videotaping our meetings, and we have just set it up on our website. So as more meetings come, I'll get with the webmaster and organize where we're actually going to place them on the website. We're kind of putting them under the news right now, but we're going to try to tie them into the actual minutes for the meeting. So bear with us on that. That's all I've got.
Do you think we could look at putting a picnic table up
there? Oh, nice.
How long it lasts.
You want to chain it to a tree.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that thing cut off. They wouldn't take it.
I'm thinking you were probably had more dealings when picnic tables are up there than
we had to chain them fast.
Yeah. How about those concrete tables and stuff that you see in some of the state parks? Or steel that are bolted right to the ground, right?
Surplus?
I've never seen picnic tables. Mm-hmm. I've seen more buffalo on there than I have.
Donkeys.
Seriously.
Yeah. Horses. We can check into it.
What website are you looking at? And the
GSA? No, they're on. Yeah, dogs. They have chickens on there.
Would you mind taking
musical instruments?
Yeah. No,
thank you.
All right, I'm done.
Scrap steel is definitely probably what we steal over.
No, actually, it's up a little bit.
Is it?
Yeah. $40 a ton. All steel. $40 a ton.
Mr. Dutcher, code enforcement, dog control.
You have my reports. I put on my code report. I've got annual stormwater floodplain manager conference coming up in May. And I found out the other day, basically, registration and hotel are essentially all paid for through CWC and or DEP or wherever they're getting their money for that. So basically it's no cost to the town or village other than traveling. So that'll be good. And that's May, I don't remember what it was, 16th through
16, 18?
Yeah. There was that, and then we have our floodplain law. We need to, I guess at this point, set a hearing date for next month. I believe next month's meeting is May 9th. Mm-hmm. Does that sound right?
Everybody has a copy of the law in front of
them. Yep. So we need to set next month as the hearing date for that, because that has to be filed by May 17th.
So we'll have we'll begin our regular meeting with a public hearing on that before we go into our regular meeting next month.
Do we need a motion for that?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
And lastly, I think I emailed out to everybody. We finally got our preliminary scores for CRS. And
it's higher
than what I expected. It came at an 8, which is a 10% discount. I was expecting a 9, which is a 5. So that was good news. Again, they're preliminary scores at this point. Ultimately, still has to be approved by FEMA. All of the legwork to this point has been done by ISO. So then that gets forwarded to FEMA, and they have to approve it. Once that's approved, then I'm sure that FEMA region will get a hold of us and do a little press release and
and all of that sort of stuff once it becomes official. So in the meantime, like I said, I was pleasantly surprised. We came out at 1,200 and changed, 1,262 I think was the score. So we're 238 points away from becoming a 7, and I've already started digging and scraping to see where we can find more points. The flood law that we're about to adopt, if both of those sections of additional language go through, I'm just ballparking probably 60 to 100 more points just by passing those laws. And there's a number of other areas that we're going to be able to pick up some points. I just didn't have enough time to get them into the first round. So I think we have to work at it, but I think once we gather enough points, we should be able to easily make it to a 7, which would be good.
That'll get us at 15?
That'll get us at 15% discount at that point. So,
how much bearing on our score did this reporter project, did that contribute a lot to that?
Probably not so much for the town. Passing a resolution to protect it as open space, basically that's where the town gained most of its points.
But how did it affect the village? I should assume
it had a good impact on the village, because it was probably a couple of acres combined, right, that with the rest of Water Street, which I had them, you know, pass a resolution to protect it. And that's where the difference between the town and the village, because most of the other points were the same, but it comes down to, in percentage, how much of your floodplain is preserved as open space. And because of the DEP land reservoir, a good chunk of it, you know, the land around the reservoir, we ended up with, I think, 26% of our floodplain is protected as open space, whereas I think the village was like 13%.
So I just want to make sure I got this straight. So the 10% that we're probably going to get, is that just in the town of Walton, outside the village, or is that included?
No, that's they deal with you by municipality.
Okay.
But both municipalities are coming in at an 8, so
okay.
Both will be looking at a 10%.
Okay. Well, and the reason I ask is because the town's was a lead agency and took the initiative on this project, and
right,
when our discussion comes up later on something else down there, I think that has a big bearing, you know, what the town spent down there that's helped village residents,
sure,
with their flood insurance.
Yeah.
So,
And I think moving forward, one of the concerns that I have at this point, again, you can also lose points.
Yeah.
And my concern is that we have, you know, with this flood map adoption process, we're going to be mapping in more floodplain. Not a lot more acreage wise, but we're going to be mapping in more, which means that our ratio of protected open space to floodplain is going to go down a little bit. So I'm working at, I've been up to Watershed Agriculture Council several times in the past 2 weeks, working with them on their WAC easements to find out, you know, where we might be able to gain some more open space, because some of their easements do overlap with floodplains. For whatever it was worth, I asked them to please, moving forward, when you're doing easements, take a look at if you've got mapped floodplain on this property. Can you, you know, include that in the easement? So, go ahead. So those are the kinds of things that I'll be doing moving forward to try to offset that, more maps, more floodplain being mapped in.
Steve, you put a lot of effort into this, and it's something that really pays back to the folks in the village. I really appreciate, and the whole town does.
Absolutely, my pleasure.
Yes, Steve, thanks.
Anything else, sir?
I think that's enough for tonight.
Okay. Well, then my turn. One of the things that Walton's very fortunate in is that we have a lot of volunteers that help out on various committees throughout the town. And One of them is our Board of Assessment Review. And a key example is Dave Budeau, who's been on the board for a long time. Mr. Budeau came forward and asked that he be relieved from his responsibilities on that board. As a result, he's submitted his letter of resignation, and I've appointed Mr. Dick Doig as the replacement on the Board of Assessment Review. He'll be picking up the board training in May when they have that preparation for a grievance day. Our new assessor is on board. He's been just got back from training up in Albany last week, so he's hit the ground running. Part of the agreement we had was to hire a trainer to bring him up to speed so that he'll be able to become a fully certified sole assessor. So looking to, and I'll entertain a motion to pay the assessor trainer 3 hours a week for a maximum of 26 hours at $30 a week per hour.
So moved.
$30 per hour.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed. I think it's probably time that we update our comprehensive plan. It was last updated in 2006, and I've talked to Mr. Sheridan, and yeah, if it's the board's pleasure, I'd entertain a motion that we go forward with that.
Make a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passed. The Gail, there is funds available from CWC, and also the planning department, county planning department, is there to help out. So please let us know how best to that the board can assist you.
And what does that exactly then entail? Like, it goes to Gail and the planning board, obviously. Is there a committee? Is it there? It's just the planning board, or
we can do it either way. Before, we've done it by going through our committee, our planning board. But I would welcome other members of the community that had any input. That
I'd be interested in knowing what you were, you know, sitting in on it or whatever. Not, you know, not trying to run it or anything. I don't mean that, but I'd be interested in what you're doing.
Okay.
So if you are going to meet,
all right.
I don't know if you meet during the day generally, and
haven't set up any meetings yet.
Okay. But even if I didn't get to every meeting, I would be interested to know stuff. So
there will be public meetings.
That's a chance for folks to review the plan and give inputs to you of what they think.
I don't know how far we're going to go. Last time we had surveys that we sent out for everyone, every community member, and got a lot of those back, and we used that information. Kevin, you might have been on the board at the time.
When was it? When was the last time we did it?
2006.
2006.
No, that was after I was on the town board, but we may have done it at one point when I was on. I don't know. We did it before that.
We'll get
go.
Started on it.
Can I see that?
Again, just another example of folks in the town that volunteered to of their time to assist, and this is a great product to guide the board. Next item is the Palmer Hill. I received a request and a petition from some of the neighbors that we heard about before, and I have a map of the property that would show you what we're talking about and why it's a concern. So as you can see, here's the property, and of course this is residences here, but all along. And what they're asking is that we request the city, and I've already talked to the city, that we make this limited to bow hunting and small game hunting. Again, still to be open to hunting.
You can hunt on city land anyway.
You can.
You can.
Yes.
Yes.
Yep.
You have to get one of their permits, usually. They're used to it.
If they have the blue sign hanging up, you don't need a permit. If it's the blue signs that say access for hiking, hunting, fishing, blah, blah, blah. If those blue signs are hanging on the property, then anybody can go access it and use it.
So the folks aren't saying no hunting or no hiking,
right.
It's just that for the safety that they're looking for grandkids, not for just the folks.
Well, for everybody, yeah. I don't have any problem with limiting that.
Did the past landowner, did they ever hunt on there, or do you know of? Or?
No.
Never, okay, so it's not like we're losing anything that, okay.
No. I mean, the landowner has had it, it's been against hunting of any kind.
Okay.
But,
yeah, for at least 30 years.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
All right, we're all hunters.
We don't have a problem with it then.
So that's where all the big deer are then.
We need to make a motion that we notify the City of New York that
yes.
It's our intention that it be hunting on, or use of it be limited to hiking and small game and yep. Bow hunting.
So are you making that motion?
Yes.
All right, then I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Thanks, folks, for again for the petition, letting us know, and again for coming in and explaining it.
No problem. Thank you, guys.
Is there a yes.
So did we do a motion to set the hearing date?
We did, didn't we?
Yes.
We talked about it, but I didn't remember voting on it.
Yes, we did.
Okay.
You seconded it.
Okay, good.
Bye-bye. Good night now.
Good night. Okay. The
I
next.
Didn't check it off.
With regards to the Moore Park land swap that we've been working on for a while, I have a resolution for us to vote on, so I'll go ahead and read it. I think you have copies of it. Maybe you don't.
No, I don't think so. Okay. Go ahead.
Resolution requesting the New York State Legislature for the authority to exchange a portion of Moore Park land for an equal adjacent parcel of land. Whereas the town of Walton requests authorization to exchange a portion of a parcel of land in the town of Walton, known as Moore Park, for an equally sized portion of land adjacent to Moore Park, as illustrated in Exhibit A, and we'll have a map to go with that. And whereas such an exchange requires parkland alienation legislation by New York State Legislature, compliance with State Environmental Quality Review Act, and surveys of both parcels, now therefore be it resolved that the town of Walton requests New York State Legislature adopt legislation authorizing the exchange of a portion of Moore Park for an equally sized portion of land adjacent to Moore Park, as illustrated in Exhibit A attached. Further resolved that the town attorney, Carly Wallace, Esquire, be hereby empowered to prepare the necessary documents to obtain such legislation, and is hereby directed to send a copy of this resolution and all supporting documentation to the New York State Senate and Assembly Home Rule Offices, Senator James L. Seward and Assemblyman Clifford Crouch, and be it further resolved that Town Supervisor Charles F. Gregory is duly authorized representative is hereby empowered to execute such agreements, documents, or papers approved as to form the Department of Law as may be necessary to implement the intent and purpose of this resolution. I'll entertain a motion that
I just have one question.
Yes.
Did we establish that there wasn't quarry under here that was worth like lots of money?
Charlie went and visited yeah. with
when I went up there, it would be years before I could ever get back to that, and for us to hold that back, it would
And I don't think so, that was their intent, yeah. quite frankly. I mean,
no.
I think it was just
it was
an
more
access
of the
and
safety.
Yes, and stuff. Yeah, I have no objection to it then. I mean, it was just.
Yep, that was a question, yes. And that was
it was just something that we should know if it was.
Yep.
So we need a motion.
I already moved it.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Okay, next is two resolutions dealing with hamlet designation. And this is a follow-up to Mr. Ogden's visit last mm-hmm. month, and which we approved going forward. So now we have the resolutions that will document that. So, first resolution is, and I shall read it. Whereas the town of Walton passed resolution number 49 in 2011 and 50 in 2011, identifying parcels within the 1997 designated hamlet area and the 2011 designated hamlet area, whereas the town board must determine whether to adopt a resolution precluding acquisition, fee, and or conservation easements within the 1997 designated hamlet area and or the 2011 designated hamlet area, whereas the town board must determine whether to adopt a resolution removing any parcel from within the 1997 designated hamlet area and or the 2011 designated hamlet area. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the town board chooses to remove map parcels numbers 251.1-48.12 and 251.1-49.2 from within the boundary from within the 1997 designated hamlet area and or the 2011 designated hamlet area. Two, the town board confirms that it is choosing at this time to preclude any DEP land acquisition, including the acquisition of conservation easements and or WAC acquisition or conservation easements within the newly defined and identified designated hamlet area in the attached exhibit A and B dated April 11th, 2016, and three, the town board reserves any and all rights under special conditions 7, 8, 9, and 10 to make new determinations in 2021. Whereupon this resolution was put to a vote and recorded as follows. Supervisor Gregory, aye. Kevin Armstrong?
Aye.
Dr. Louis Rodriguez Bencourt?
Aye.
Lynn Govern?
Aye.
Patty Wood?
Aye.
Therefore, it will be signed by the town clerk with this date and time. The next resolution associated with that, resolution requesting the New York State Legislature for the equal authority exchange portion and more and more park land for an equal adjacent parcel. I'm sorry, I'm being confused, am I? That's the one we just did.
We didn't call roll.
We didn't call roll on that.
Okay. Ah, thank you. Okay. As previously read, calling roll. Charles Gregory, supervisor, aye. Kevin Armstrong?
Aye.
Dr. Rodriguez?
Aye.
Lynn Govern?
Aye.
Patty Wood?
Aye.
Who made the motion for the hamlet designation? I need a motion and a second for that one.
I seconded it, I think.
Okay, pull me down this.
Armstrong? Okay.
Okay. The next, I want to discuss the Moore Park land, I'm sorry, the green space discussions. And I'm going to start out with kind of a recap of how we got to where we are. So please bear with me, folks. This is going to take a while. Basically, we're talking about the Reporter Company building, which is now the town's green space in the heart of the village. Today, we received a village water bill forwarded from the county, the treasurer's office, for the green space where the Walton Porter Company building used to be. And before we go into this, I want to kind of recap for the folks that may not be familiar with it, just kind of the history on it. Regretfully, the former Reporter Company building was devastated in the 2006 flood. The Reporter Company moved out of the building. Pretty soon it became abandoned and just became a really bad eyesore. Along the way, the county acquired the property for back taxes. In May 23rd, 2014, the town of Walton took the initiative to and applied for a grant to raise the building, and they were successful in achieving $100,000 to go towards that. On April 29th, 2015, the town board approved the purchase of the building from the county, which had acquired it, as I mentioned, for taxes. In July of 2015, last July, the demolition of the building began and grading of the new lot to be a green space. In 2015, on August 15th of the month, the town crew assisted the village in digging and installing a new water line for one of the commercial industries down there to support them before they laid the new parking lot. And in August, the project project was expanded to include repaving the village parking lot adjacent to the green space. The cost of the parking lot project alone was $43,434, of which the village contributed $20,000 towards resurfacing the parking lot. Now the specifics of the water bill that we received today. To aid in this endeavor, we asked the village to give us a detailed breakdown of the bill. And they provided that starting with April 1st, 2014. On April 1st, 2014, the village assessed a penalty of $76.47 of interest and penalties to an existing bill. On May 6, 2014, the payment was made by the, I will assume, the county. A payment was made, I know that, for $385.07, which was received by the village. Basically, what happened is the bill came out, the bill was paid, but it didn't go in until May, and so interest and penalties were charged to that bill. This is a bill in May of 2014. The following April, end of April 2015, the town board approved the purchase of the Reporter Company building. On May 13th of 2015, the county board of supervisors approved the sale of the town, the sale of that property to the town so it could be demolished. In January, the town received a bill from the county, from the village, for $469 for interest and penalties accrued since 2014. As a result, the board discussed this at our February meeting and decided to send a letter to the village requesting relief. And I'll read that letter, dated February 10th, 2016. Dear Mayor Snow, I would like to follow up on our brief conversation at Monday's town board meeting regarding the future of the site of the former Walton Reporter building on Delaware Street, specifically regarding the forming of a joint town-village committee to examine how best to utilize the space while maintaining its primary purpose as flood mitigation. To this effect, I've asked Councilwoman Patty Wood and Councilman Dr. Luis Rodriguez Betancourt to serve as the town members of the committee that would invite you to appoint village representatives as well. I also feel that our shared floodplain manager could play an important role in the process, basically working together with the village to come up with the site plan for the green space. Furthermore, I envision the ultimate goal of this committee is to come up with a site plan for the space included to include the placement of the flagpole, generously donated by the Walton Chamber of Commerce, as well as exploring other ideas such as placement of the pavilion, a veterans memorial kiosk, community Christmas tree, and any other ideas that the committee might choose to consider. In addition to the site plan, a memorandum of understanding between the town and village addressing snow removal, grass mowing, and utilities, if applicable, might be useful. Finally, the town requests the village waive the balance of the $469.26 for the water bill and any associated penalty fee. I spoke to the county treasurer and she explained that she had discussed the matter previously and he had told her that he would follow up with the matter. Regretfully, it appears this has not happened and the county is still getting billed for it. So basically, we asked the village, would you work with us in coming up with green space? And also, would you relieve us from the penalties and interest that have been accrued since 2014 by the county? We received a reply from the village on March 22nd, 2016. And I think it's best that I will read the reply as well. Dear Supervisor Gregory, I am in receipt of your letter of February 10th, 2016. Trustees Allen, Tink Reynolds, and Teresa O'Leary have agreed to represent the village as members of the Joint Town-Village Committee to examine the possibilities for the green space on Delaware Street owned by the town. I have noted your request for the village to waive the balance of the water bill, which is now $648.25, including all penalties and the county's portion of the $335.14. The matter was discussed at our most recent board meeting, as well as As you well know from your time as a village trustee, the village has no assistance from the county, as the town does, with property taxes. To date, the village has sacrificially waived the outstanding village taxes of approximately $12,000 for this project. In light of this fact, the board has unanimously decided that at this time, we are fiscally unable to forgive yet another debt. If you have any further questions, I can be reached. Sincerely, yours truly, Ed Snow, Walton Mayor. So, and I have a copy. I think you've all have a copy of the breakdown. Yep. Mm-hmm. Well, that's so what we're talking about, and again, like I think probably happened, was when the bill was paid by the county, they paid what they had in hand, but it got there late and there were fees added on, and ever since then it's just been adding and adding and adding. So,
but it was a $76 balance, and that's gone a long way for a building that has not had any use.
Yep. I find it absurd that they can't just forgive that bill after all the town of Walton took the initiative to do that project. And we have well over $100,000 in it. We paid the majority of their parking lot, we paid for. If Walt was here, he could tell you, because he sent us an email, what our town crew and manpower and material spent to run that water line. I think it was like $1,300 or $1,500. This project has benefited the village, potentially will benefit the village people are paying on flood insurance by lowering their rates to, you know, it's got to have a, like I asked Steve earlier, that's got to be one of the major reasons that we, you know, got the community rating system number that we did. That water bill, I mean, it wasn't like we were running water down there. You know, most of this is late fees and penalties. I mean, I cannot believe, you know, then they put in here, then they're holding against us at the county level, won't help them out with taxes. That's a whole separate issue, you know. This project has done nothing but benefit the village of Walton. As a taxpayer, as somebody who lives outside the village, maybe I think that money should have been spent outside the village for other projects. But we decided as a board, and I agreed to it too, to spend the money in here. I think it's a slap in our face to get hit with this bill and they can't forgive it. I mean, that's just my opinion on it.
In the original discussion, as I recall from when we talked about going forward with the reporter company building, that the village and the town were both going to apply for grant money to help with taking it down, and the village never followed through on it.
Which is why the town was awarded it, and we continued to do it anyway.
What was even more amazing is that even during the process that we have in the discussion, they keep taxing, adding fees and services to it. I mean, by 2 months from now, it's going to be $1,000. It's pretty ridiculous.
I mean, that's if we pay that, the taxpayers in the village are going to foot that bill too, aren't they? I mean,
basically what the village is asking is to add another tax on the taxpayers to cover these fees.
Yeah.
What started out in no good deed goes
unpunished.
Bruce Dolph, you and the board here played a big role in really enhancing Delaware Street. That's very commendable. You guys took a risk and fought for that money, got it. It really speaks well for the folks sitting at this table, and Mr. Dolph as well. So to come back and say, well, we want you to pay interest and penalties.
It's petty. It's petty at best. Especially since they contributed $20,000 to the paving of the parking lot, which was a $43,000. Yes. And that's not even talking about the water line. That was another $13,000,
$15,000.
Yeah, I mean, they're biting off their nose to spite their face.
Maybe we
the
should
way
submit a bill to them for our time and materials doing that project.
And I don't want to hear that this is the village versus the town. There is no village versus the town. If there was, the town wouldn't have done this to begin with. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it gets played that way, and I don't want to hear that. It just annoys me to even think about that. This should have been a non-issue, in my opinion, and I think it's petty.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll move on.
I will say, I talked to Tinker. You weren't around. I did see Tinker. we're pretty much on the same page. The flagpole, the Veterans Memorial, some kind of a pavilion. And I'd like to see the tree there. I don't know if that's feasible or not. I mean, that's something that I would like to see. It's going to take years for a tree to the size of the one that's at the National Bank, but the National Bank's not the National Bank, or it won't be. I don't know what that will play out anyway. My point of the tree being off of, that's a busy corner, that's where that tree is. You put it at the back of there, the parade could go loop around and it would be off of the main street. So, you said, I think, a tree there?
We have to sit down and take a look at what everybody's talking about wanting to put down there and where they're wanting to put it, because we can't sacrifice its initial purpose.
Right, absolutely. First of all, the pavilion we're talking about is like a run-through thing.
A few strategically placed items are okay.
I would think that the pavilion would want, anything you put on there would want to be towards Delaware. I mean, if you look at where the water lays down there, I mean, somebody sent me a picture the other day when it was right full of water. I mean, I went through later in the day and it drained down. Hopefully, that'll improve once we do the rest of the project.
Well, right, but right now, that's all it is a holding spot until the rest
of the project. Well, that's what it's, I mean, and that's what it was meant to do.
Right. Yeah.
But, I mean, it does, granted, it doesn't drain as fast as we want, but the project's not. There's more to this project than just doing that, so.
Right. When Water Street side, or the other side of Water Street done, then there will be some sort of drainage, either lowering Water Street to allow water to pass over top of, or sluice pipes underneath, whatever. We still need to make a decision on that, but there will be some sort of drainage to get rid of that surface water.
My concern is that we've got to move on what we're going to do down there for the money, or we're going to lose.
And when is that? Lose. When do we need to move?
I'm in conversation with her, well, since last Friday, and we're finalizing everything. The 2014 grant that was worth $50,000, we did not spend all of that. So they are allowing us to carry money over from that grant. In order to do so, though, we have to get the approval and sponsorship from Senator Bonasek's office. So we're in the process of doing that. And then once that's complete, hopefully we can finalize the 2015 project, which is the $100,000 project. Finalize that one, start getting payment in from that. And then the 2014 project will be held up just a little bit until we can finalize this pavilion, because they still need the quotes and everything. You know.
Now, we had quotes on this, right?
We had quotes on, yes, on the pavilion, but they wanted to know how much it was actually going to cost to have the kit that we talked about, having that put up, installed. So they really need that detail so they can, before they can finalize that project.
That's the 2014?
That's the 2014, yep, $50,000 grant.
So what do we need to do to get them that information? We need to go out to...
We need to go out to bid.
To bid for installing.
Yeah, and double check on the quotes to make sure that they're still valid prices.
And Patty, Doc, the County Planning Department offered assistance if you need them. Of course, keep Gail in the loop. If you need, and they could bring a hire a consultant to assist you if you want to have that to help.
I don't think it's that big a project to do that. Yeah. I mean, maybe
yes and no, because there's a world of potential for utilizing the property on the other side of Water Street, between Water Street and the river, once that area gets reclaimed. And my own personal opinion is, I don't think we want to, we got a nice shiny green space here, let's do something with it, and then we get floodplain reclaimed and we've got huge space down there to do something, some recreational, sports related, whatever, and then you treat that on an isolated island, and then you don't have the two tied together. It doesn't make sense.
I don't understand what you're saying.
That I think what you're saying is that if because it is part of the bigger project,
Right, but we're talking about a flagpole with a monument here in the front, some kind of pavilion here.
What he's saying,
maybe a tree.
What he's saying is that could also be on the other side.
That's not on Delaware Street, though.
No, I know. I think that's what he's saying.
What I'm saying is that we're not talking anything extensive on this property.
I understand.
Put in as much discussion as we probably already have put into it, quite frankly. We have talked this to death for a pavilion, a flag, and a tree, a possible tree.
Yeah. I think that the two items that are the primary is the flag, right, and the pavilion. Mm-hmm. And the way that we decided to move on the pavilion was something that's non-obstructing at all.
Right.
But I think that pavilion there opens a whole bunch of opportunities for things like, for example, farmers markets or craft fairs and things like that, given the fact that there's a parking right beside it that people can use to park on and all that.
You do concerts. I mean, you do a lot of things.
All kinds of stuff. But no. But the fact that the parking is right there makes it a prime place to put that pavilion on.
Very nice parking, thanks to us.
Yes.
Do you think you might have a proposal to bring by our next meeting? Is that?
We could do that, couldn't we?
Sure.
Gail, maybe we can meet with you too.
Pardon?
Maybe we could meet with you too, Louie.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But like I said, I talked to Tinker, and he's of that same idea.
Good.
So I haven't talked to Teresa. I haven't seen her, but I don't think that it's. I don't think there's contention there. I hope.
I know the county has some money available if we want a consultant or we want. I know one time we had the class from Delhi Tech come down and look at what kind of things could be done.
But the thing is that we don't want to do a lot there.
Mm. So we can't.
Well, right. Yeah. Well, we don't want to anyway. I mean, that's the thing is that so I don't. I just don't think a lot of consultants make a difference there. If it was a different park, I would totally want that, you know. But this isn't really a park. This is, we're going to put a couple of niceties in the green space to make it not just stuff that they drive over for fun.
Mm-hmm.
While we're still on this subject of that area over there, other than voicing some opinion about the water bill, I think I would like to see us send a letter back to the village and express to them the fact that we put about, and get the exact number from Walt, we put about $1,500 of labor and town machinery into running that water line for them, which saved them that money. And also point out to them that we also have about $23,000 in change in their parking lot.
And maybe the CRS rating.
And maybe they should reconsider their position on the penalties and fees for the water bill.
Whereas we didn't even own it for most of the time that they're talking about penalties and fees.
Yeah, it was Mr. Berkey, I think, who didn't pay that bill is where it came from.
Well, but they got paid all the $76. Yeah. Anyway, so that must have been Berkey's. So this must really, I don't think this is any water running.
No.
It's just
this is just.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. So it didn't, it's not like they were pumping.
The more it makes it ridiculous that they keep tax adding penalties and something that doesn't exist. Okay.
To tell you the truth, when this all started, I thought this was for actual water from the time. But this May 2014 payment of the counties.
And there's, I don't know how they do it between municipalities or with a municipal-owned property, but there's also a quarterly base charge. Whether you're running water or not, there's a quarterly base charge. The capital fee is in there, $50, I think, something like that.
So I think that's what most of it is.
I did talk to Walt at our highway committee meeting about possibly going down and hitting that again with the hydro seeder too. If it doesn't start coming in better, so he said they, you know, if it doesn't, they could probably do that again. So.
And who is going to mow it?
Bill, is
that's
that?
That's
committee members.
Yeah.
You mow it the first week of the month. Doc gets it the second week. Tink gets it the third.
I'm sure we can work on
it. It's not how fast you mow.
We can probably work out with someone for summer help on the highway or maybe Milt. They do the cemetery someday.
Yeah.
Our Rock and his crew. So.
But what I'm saying, the last thing we want is that it should not be mowed.
Right,
yeah. We cannot
let that happen.
Exactly.
I agree.
The right. Village code officer will be sending you an Instagram. If it
another one.
Another one.
I paid my dog, but I would have to have that.
Okay.
I think it's against the law to mow wetland.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe there's some.
We'll talk to DEC and get the clearance of
the wetland. The next thing, and I know you'd be happy to hear the last thing on my portion of the agenda, is one of the topics that's coming up before the County Board of Supervisors on Wednesday is is a resolution dealing with the solar farms. And basically it's a county resolution that would apply only to commercial properties, not residential or farm properties. So it's folks that want to put solar on their home or out the farm, that'd be okay, but for solar farms, that's where this would kick in. Currently, the state law states that for solar, wind, and waste energy projects, they're tax-free for 15 years. There is an exception to that, though, and that's by negotiating a 15-year pilot program that would basically bring in money in lieu of taxes. Benefit of that would be it would avoid, if it were assessed, then each year they could come back to the Board of Assessment Appeals and appeal that. So this would be dependable for the municipality, and also we'd be in control, but to avoid the potential for future litigation. Finally, the split right now, based on the assessed values, comes about 10. The town would get 10%, 23% for the county, and the school would get 67%. Of the assessed taxes. The resolution that's going forward changes that so that the town would get 50% instead of 10%. The county would get 25% and the school would get 25%. So I'll read the resolution. And again, it's just, I wanted y'all to be aware of what was going forward. So forgive me as I go through a reading. Resolution authorizing entry into a host community benefit agreements as payment in lieu of taxes for commercial solar installation in Delaware County, real property tax services. Whereas, the County of Delaware wishes to cooperate and partner with the towns, villages, school districts in creating a unified policy to deal with the taxable status of commercial solar installations, and whereas the real estate parcels that contain those solar installations will fall into overlapping taxing districts, and whereas the New York State Real Property Tax Law, Section 487 sub 9, states that solar, wind, and farm waste energy projects are exempt from property taxes for a period of 15 years, but are eligible to contribute to their host community through pilot agreements, and whereas the County of Delaware and many of the towns, villages, and school districts agree that residential and agricultural solar projects should be tax exempt, but commercial solar projects should pay their fair share of costs of municipal expenses, and whereas the residential solar projects are defined as projects located and inhabited at inhabited dwellings connected to a single phase grid or no larger than 20 kilowatts in size, and whereas agricultural solar projects are defined as projects located on lands which qualify for exemptions under real property tax law 483, and whereas commercial solar projects are defined any projects other than those defined above as residential and agriculture, and therefore upon approval of this resolution, it is understood that the host community benefit agreements will be put into place for all new commercial solar installations, and no action is needed as far as opting out of the automatic tax exemption by any of the taxing districts. Each taxing entity will leave the state adopted exemption in place. The town will be the lead agency in negotiating and ensuring the host community benefit agreements are in place. Furthermore, all commercial solar panel arrays will be subject to host community benefit agreements pilot as to be put into place by the town, and proceeds of which will be shared by each taxing district on a prorated amount, 50% for the town, 25% for the county, and 25% for the school. Whereas all residential and agricultural installations would remain as tax exempt for 15 years unless the law changes regarding tax exempt status, this resolution only applies to commercial installations. Whereas under section 487 sub 9 of the real property tax law, the host community benefit agreement must not exceed the amount of taxes that the entity would have paid on the new array if it were not tax exemption. For example, a $100,000 solar farm built on a $5,000 plot of land, the agreement cannot exceed what the property taxes would have been on a $105,000 assessed value. And whereas it is understood that agreements made pursuant to this resolution shall be for 15 years and that the revenue will be divided among the taxing districts as described above. Now therefore be it resolved that the County of Delaware Board of Supervisors is in agreement with the multi-jurisdictional cooperation agreement. I share this with you for a couple reasons. One is going to be coming before the County Board of Supervisors on Wednesday, but also looking downstream, if a company wants to put a solar array someplace in the township, then we will see action from this. So at this point, eventually I believe they're looking to send a resolution down to the towns for us to vote on. Mm-hmm. But at this point, it's just information only.
Okay.
Any Thank questions?
You. Nope.
I think it would be very important for our planning board, because right now we do have rules and regulations, but we don't address the taxing situation. So we're kind of hanging out there without this.
Committee reports. Do we have any committee reports?
I'm supposed to, Patty and I are supposed to be working on the river flood gauge. And to be honest, I haven't had a quiet week yet. I thought we were going to, hopefully maybe in the next few days, but then I was late today because I had to go to Martinville this afternoon. So
I casually mentioned to Graydon I needed to talk to him. That's as far as I've gotten to. So I haven't done anything about it either.
And I mentioned to him also that we had been talking to him.
It's not been forgotten, it's just
on the back
burner at the moment.
Okay.
Verizon's moving out. Well, I'm assuming that's all of the paperwork is done and now we're just waiting for them to hook up.
If they should have everything now, and they were hoping by the end of the year. We have sent a letter to to Aldi asking them if they'd be interested in opening a store here. I talked to the rep today. It's been forwarded to their real estate. There's a long process for them to evaluate the economic feasibility of bringing a store like that to Walton, but we'll see what we're pushing, so they know we're interested in.
At least we're in line.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If not, any other committee reports, then I'll entertain a motion to approve the abstracts.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passed. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to go into executive session to discuss ongoing contract negotiations, ongoing litigation to include Sydney Federal Credit Union, Kraft Assessment, and an ongoing investigation.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passed. Yes, ma'am.
I have a couple questions. First of all, the Hamlet designation, I'm assuming you enlarged your Hamlet area?
No.
We took a parcel out of it.
Yeah, two parcels, right?
Two tax parcels.
We downsized it on request of the owners to the property.
And we've done that in the past, following precedence. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And where were those parcels?
Minded now?
Murphy Hill. Yep.
Well, right now. I mean, but.
And last question.
End in sight.
For Moore Park, you're just swapping.
Yep.
Yes. Yep. Yeah.
Can you give me like some kind of idea, like map wise, doing that?
Yes, the area that the town will be acquiring is right around where the cross is, the star is.
Okay.
Prepare. Our attorney takes good care of us.
Can I take a photo of that?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
Do you have to?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I just don't know. This is the proposed swap.
Okay.
So this going to Bruce Taylor, this coming from Bruce Taylor.
So it's 26, oh, same.
Yep, same acreage.
Gotcha. It's a even swap, it's just that our, what we owned was in the back, what he owned was in the front where the star is, they
right.
maintaining yeah. it, is saying that gives him better access, so it's just a swap.
Okay, mm-hmm. Got it, so it's just
something they had come and asked us about, they yeah. initiated.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And because it's a park, mm-hmm. that's why we need state legislative
right.
approval.
Right, gotcha. All right, thank you.
And, you might like a copy of this.
Yeah. I like you.
Yep, yes.
Yep.